Parets sile lugintiner yes Rafi Manugyan em glandeli khaki kantsabash shnoragal em vor gmianak ints aisor shat urakh em vor aisor yurahadukhyur munim mer aisor vahyurne nahanki kantsabah Fiona ma anandervaz nahanki kantsabah noemper 2018-in em stantsnats e yerbashtona hunvar 2019-in Korzov CPA yev uni masters in business administration from Pepperdine University en stantsats e kvenerun patsrakuina California Kantsabaheru 7.8 million kvenerov yev yev bashtonavaraz e California Board of Equalization 2015-en 2019-a California State Assembly nergatsuchner duna California-i 2006-en 2012 yev San Francisco Board of Supervisors 2002-ken 2006 Today our guest is California State Treasurer Fiona Ma who was elected by the highest number of votes for any treasurer in the state of California, 7.8 million votes. Madam Treasurer, welcome to our program. Thank you for taking the time to be here with us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Rafi, for inviting me.
Absolutely. And I know you, as I said, you got elected to the highest number of votes to the state, to the office of the, one of the eight executive offices for the state of California, the fifth largest economy in the state. You have, you know, I compare my office, I don't compare my office to yours as a city treasurer. I have a staff of four and I manage a portfolio of approximately $800 million. And can you tell us about your office and your staff and what is your operation
here?
Office.
Yes, so I have 450 staff members.
That's a few members more than mine,
I believe.
A little bit, yes.
But what's interesting, in 2000 we had 450 people, and today we only have 450 people.
That's
unusual for government.
Very
right?
unusual, yes.
But I have very, very highly qualified, professional, dedicated team members at the State Treasurer's Office. Over $2 billion goes through my office.
Billion as in boy.
Billion as in boy. I'm sorry, $2
trillion.
$2 trillion. So every tax, fee, fine, interest that people pay to all the state agencies goes through my office.
So all the income taxes, everything goes through your office.
Yep. And then as the state banker, I invest whatever the state is not using, so about $80 billion. Okay. And then also $20 billion for local governments like the city of Glendale.
Yes, the local governments need that additional funding.
Exactly. And then I also oversee about $95 billion in bonds.
Okay.
So that's like my main job, the heart of the state treasurer's office.
Right.
Then, because of former treasurer Jess Unruh, he realized the importance of this, you know, this position and how much money we have, and so he created about 15 different boards, commissions, and authorities that fund schools, hospitals, transportation, alternative energy, affordable housing. So everything that's happening in the state of California, I have some sort of nexus to, either through a grant, loan, or a bond program.
Right, right.
Yeah.
I know from talking about you personally a little bit, I know your family immigrated to the United States. Could you tell us about the experience of your family, how you guys came to the United States, and your experience from the East Coast to the West Coast?
Yeah, so my parents were both born in China.
Okay.
Left before the communists.
Your grandfather was the first mayor?
He was the first mayor of Kunming.
Okay.
Yeah, so on my father's side, he had three brothers, and they were all generals in the army.
Okay.
But then there was a change in government, and so either they had to leave, or many of them actually went to jail.
Right.
My father and his younger sister and two young twins were the chosen ones to leave and flew to Hong Kong.
Okay.
He still to this day doesn't know why he was chosen. He was like number 9 out of 11 brothers and sisters.
Oh, goodness.
So he ended up in Hong Kong, and he got a scholarship to the University of Saskatchewan.
Okay.
So he ended up in Canada. At that time, my mother, also born in China, Hong Kong, was in Ontario, Toronto, and they met at a church picnic because my mom was the only daughter of a minister.
You can change the Chinese to Armenian, and it's all the same story.
Okay, there you go.
They meet at church and, you know, have children.
Exactly. And, so then my grandfather moved to a church in New York City.
He was a pastor?
He was a pastor. He was a Presbyterian minister.
Okay.
Who encountered Presbyterian missionaries in China back then. You know, most people are Buddhist back then.
Right.
And somehow he, you know, met missionaries and became a Presbyterian minister. So he moved to New York. My mom moved to New York and went to the city college, CCNY. And my dad's a couple years older than my mom, and so he followed her, and then that's where they got married.
Right.
I was actually conceived in Glasgow.
Okay.
My dad got a scholarship to the University of Glasgow, and so my parents were living in Scotland, hence how I got my
whirlwind, you know, experience.
Yep. But my mom said, hey, I'm not going to have her in Scotland, England, so I'll see you back in New York. And so my dad came back to New York, and that's where I was born and raised. Lived the first couple of years with my grandparents in Chinatown because my parents were working in Yonkers, saving money during the week.
Right.
And so I lived with my grandparents. And then after 4 years, they saved enough money with a little loan from her parents to buy their first home in Great Neck, Long Island.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So, and you went to school in New York?
I went to school, yep. So I went to, you know, I was able to walk to my elementary school, junior high and high school. And I decided to go to the Rochester Institute of Technology because it was only a short 5 or 6 hour drive.
Right,
my parents wouldn't let me get on a plane, you know, back then because that
right.
was expensive,
right,
you know, scary.
Right.
So that's where I decided to go to school. And by that time, my parents moved to San Francisco. Again, my grandfather moved churches.
Right.
And my parents said, okay, after you're done with undergrad, we'll see you in San Francisco. And I've been here since 1988.
Wow. That's like I said, a whirlwind you know experience in terms of get elections and all of that in terms of an immigrant experience in the United States. And you decided at one point to get involved with politics. What was your impetus for starting as a political activist and what you've done?
Yeah, so like you as a CPA, right? Interviewed with all of the big 8 accounting firms back then, and I decided to take a job with Ernst & Whinney in the real estate tax group.
Right.
They merged with Ernst & Young to become Ernst & Young a year later, and I worked there for 5 years. Did all of my audit hours, and then got my master's in taxation, which they paid for.
Right.
And then I decided to leave and start my own practice. There weren't a lot of women, people of color in the firm, and so I decided to start my own practice and really focused on small businesses. Became president of the Asian Business Association.
Right.
Got involved in the 1995 White House Conference on Small Business under Bill Clinton.
Right.
Went to Sacramento to testify on bills, and so that really was my impetus in getting involved in politics, is helping small business owners.
Right. And you got first you got elected to board of supervisors for the San Francisco. Actually, and there was a lot of work that you did in terms of as a supervisor with businesses as well as helping children.
Yes, yeah. So back then, Willie Brown, that was his last year as mayor, and then Gavin Newsom was the mayor for 3 years.
Right, of San Francisco.
Of San Francisco. So I worked on trying to get rid of the payroll tax because we were the only city and county that had a payroll tax.
Okay.
Hence why we have tech and biotech companies outside of San Francisco, South San Francisco, Emeryville, Berkeley, Oakland, because we had this payroll tax. So that was one of my, because of, I'm a tax accountant and I know how sensitive companies
businesses,
are, businesses are to taxes. We put an initiative on the ballot. It did not pass. But 10 years later, now we got rid of the payroll tax, and all the tech companies now are in San Francisco and biotech as well.
Payroll tax meaning like a business tax where based on their payroll, they pay a certain percentage.
Exactly. So, companies used to have to pay based on their people that they hired, and a lot of these companies don't make money.
Right.
But they had to pay all these taxes out, and so they didn't come to San Francisco. So, you know, a lot of tax initiatives. I worked on human trafficking at the time.
Right.
There are a lot of different international rings that bring immigrants here to this country, take away their passport, cut all their communication from their families.
Right.
And so there were 2 busts of human trafficking rings in my district when I started. And so I created a law that would make it more difficult for massage establishments to open up. They now have to go through a conditional use permit.
Right.
So someone, an owner, has to come before the board and say who they are, get fingerprinted, and what type of operation they're going to start. Right. And so that really cut down on a lot
illegal. And the toxins from children's children's toys.
Yep. So on the Board of Supervisors, I passed a law to ban phthalates and bisphenol A. Those are the chemicals that make plastics hard and soft, like in rubber duckies
or
the Nalgene bottles that we have. And because San Francisco has a precautionary principle, it's much easier to pass those type of laws because it doesn't have to be on specifically scientific evidence, scientific evidence, but it's if something is thought to cause harm, we should probably do something to protect it.
So I sooner rather than later.
Sooner than later. So I did that in San Francisco. Right. Then when I got elected to the assembly, I tried to pass a similar law statewide and found that in Sacramento, people hire lobbyists, a lot of lobbyists, for all sorts of things to protect the status quo and not to change it. And so I had a difficult time, but I managed to get it to Governor Schwarzenegger's office.
He
didn't want to sign it either, but we put a lot of pressure through his, you know, his former wife, Maria Shriver, also, who was strongly supporting us. And so I got that signed, and that was probably my biggest, most significant piece of legislation.
Absolutely.
Dianne Feinstein passed it at the federal level, and now same legislation. So any toy that now comes and is sold in the United States does not have this toxic chemical in it.
Oh, wonderful!
Yeah,
congratulations on
that.
I think protecting children from harmful chemicals that they don't know about. You know, the general public doesn't know about some of the chemicals that I use to build some of these toys.
Yeah.
As state treasurer, you've been there a year. So far, how has this current year been for you as an experience at the highest levels of the state government?
Yeah, so it's been great. We have another surplus year.
I know you have a hashtag, I love my job.
Hashtag love my job, which I do, because I feel like I'm finally qualified for a job. Like the learning curve isn't quite as steep as my other positions.
Because of your financial background.
Yes, because of my financial background. Plus, there's a lot of tax. Budgeting, you know, financial statements. I'm also on GASAC, which is the Government Accounting Standards Advisory Council. So we advise the GASB members.
Right.
So making sure our financial statements are, you know, GAAP certified and you know, apples to apples. And so, you know, these are things we learned in accounting classes.
So financial statements are comparable. So you can compare one
in
the same industry, one financial statement to the other.
Exactly. So we sold about 14 different bonds last year. All of them did as or better than expected. And you never know, in the market,
Right. Stock and you saved a lot of money to the taxpayers
because
of the refinancing.
We saved about $2.7 billion.
By refinancing the bonds.
By refinancing those higher interest bonds during the Great Recession.
Right.
Moody's and Fitch upgraded us in the fall. So as a sign that they support California's economy and the way we are running the state. So that was good news.
Absolutely, and I bought some of those bonds for the city of Glendale, actually.
Okay, good. Thank you. And you're also on one of my committees.
Yes.
To make sure that we are managing local government's money
properly.
We also increased the limit for local governments to invest in us from 65 to 75 million. And we're kind of like a free checking account for local governments, right?
Right, absolutely.
And we earn 2% on your money.
Yes, and all local governments can benefit from it.
Yes.
And it's a wonderful program that I use for the city of Glendale
as well.
And we invest quite a bit in the local agency investment fund as well, which is great. And you have been, I think you're one of the most successful and active treasurers that I have ever seen for the state of California, and you need to be congratulated on it because it's not easy, being that active, including social media as well as personally appearing to all the communities that request of you to appear and being there for everyone, for the local community as well, as well as the state governments. You are active helping children in terms of the in terms of saving for college.
And Scholarshare 529 is a program. We're really actively trying to encourage more, you know, parents, uncles, grandparents, aunts to open up savings account for their kids or their relatives. They don't have high student loan debt. That is really crippling many of our millennials who are graduating and not able to afford to
having,
buy a
having
home.
Three children of college age, I can attest to that, actually, that it's difficult going to college for some of the younger kids.
So we are actively encouraging savings. Also today I was here with BizFed to promote our Cal Savers account.
Which is?
That is a new account that started last year. Senator DeLeon was a major proponent of it, as well as my former colleague, Treasurer John Chung. And it would basically be available to any employer who does not provide a pension plan for their employees. So if they have five or more employees, they will be at some point required to enroll their employees with our CalSavers plan, meaning they sign them up, give us their name, their social security number, and we anticipate and hope that they will withdraw money out of their W-2 salaries every month and continue to save for as long as they need to. So
basically it's a savings program for the employees so they can have something for the future.
It's like a post-tax Roth IRA account. So they can save post-tax and if they need the money for some reason, they can also withdraw it without any penalty. But the beauty is there is no other responsibility for the employer. So a lot of employers, small business owners, they want to offer
something
full
for their employees,
benefits, retirement plans, but sometimes it's expensive, it's confusing, there's a lot of liability associated with it. And so this is really gonna be very, very easy for small business owners. And we can also enroll independent contractors now.
That's certainly that certainly is a plus, because a lot of independent independent contractors don't know how to apply and qualify for some of these retirement plans.
And again, it's under my office, so you know, guaranteed or overseen, administered by the state of California. Employees can put up to $6,000.
And the earnings on these, if you said it's like Roth IRA, the earnings on these savings accounts are tax-free?
They're tax-free.
Okay, the earnings on it.
The earnings are tax-free as well. They can withdraw it without a penalty. They can save up to $6,000 a year. And there's no maximum limit, so they can put in, you know, as much as they want for as long as they want. But we have found that when people have an automatic deduction from their paycheck, they tend to keep it open, and it goes with the employee from job to job. So let's say your employee leaves for some reason, you are no longer responsible for that employee. They are going to keep that account in their name and it follows them. So it's
so they go to another job and still have a deduction and still contribute to the savings account. That's a great program. The state of California, everyone, federal, even federal issues, they are dealing with homeless issue and housing. What kind of programs does the city, I'm used to saying city treasurer, the state treasurer is involved in with the housing programs in the state?
So I also oversee the 9% and the 4% affordable housing tax credits that helps developers, you know, pencil their projects. So we have been very actively, I did 15 housing tours earlier last year. We've been reforming both of my agencies, SIDLAC as well as TCAC, working closely with the governor's office on housing, and then instituting new programs like No Place Like Home. That is going to be money that will house formerly homeless, those with severe mental illness, kind of the hardest people to house. We are going to be putting more money into those type of projects. The governor also put $500 million last year, $500 million this year for workforce housing. Those are the people that have a job, two family workers. So we're going to you know, create more incentives to create more of that type of housing as well.
How does the credits that the 4% and 9% credits you said, how does that help a local community that needs, let's take Glendale, needing affordable housing? How would the 4% and the 9% credits work to their advantage so they can provide more housing for the community?
Right. So it's usually the developers, if they want to provide affordable housing, right? People can only pay a certain amount of rent, right? Maybe $500, $750, $1,000. Yet the fair market value could be $2,500 or $3,000.
So that's actually the reality.
That is the reality. So that's how these credits help the developers pencil, so they're able to apply for the credits and then sell them. So it's kind of part of their financing package. So along with their bank, they get some of the credits to help subsidize. They may get some local assistance,
local funding
either
as well,
local
from
funding,
the cities,
right? If your you know, your electorate passes certain housing bonds, or free land from the government, that's always very, very helpful. And so it's really complicated to do these affordable housing projects.
And I've been involved in approving as a council member, former council member, in approving some of these programs, and they're very beneficial locally, and we have a number of projects in Glendale that deal with, that help individuals rent apartments for themselves and for their parents so in an affordable basis, actually.
And you know, as we retire, people want to stay in the community. They don't want to have to move like all the way out, you know, to the suburbs someplace. And so, you know, my focus, since folks are getting older and living longer, is to try to build senior community living. Mixed in
closer to amenities.
Closer to amenities, but also, you know, a lot of seniors, they may have retired, but they can still care, be caretakers, they can still babysit, you know, take care of kids. So, you know, trying to build those communities that are more like family friendly and not just, you know, families are over here, homeless are over here, you know, seniors are over there. I mean, like, we should all be living and helping each other.
And supporting each other.
And supporting each other
on a daily basis. You have a number of other programs as well, master plan for aging and food safety programs. In about a minute, could you give us kind of a, I know they're huge programs, but give us a synopsis of what they are.
So we're very active in sponsoring bills, and so the Master Care Plan for Aging were three bills that I sponsored to try to think more holistically about what it is to age in place, right? 60 to 70, 70 to 80, 80 to 90, 90 to 100 years, those are different needs. So that was that plan. One of them got signed, the other two the governor put into his master care plan on aging. And then another one we're trying to stand up is CHFIC, the California Healthy Foods Initiative Council, because food insecurity is so it's becoming more and more of an issue with older folks on fixed income, kids in poverty, families that are trying to make make ends meet. So trying to figure out how we can be a catalyst to ensure that the people who need the food are going to get good quality access, healthy foods.
To healthy foods. That is important. Our time is almost completed. I want to thank you for coming by and giving us this discussion about the operations of the state treasurer. Usually people don't have a clue as to, locally, I mean, as to what is going on in Sacramento and the work that you do, and I want to commend you on that work.
Thank you.
Wish you all the luck. I will do everything I can to help you.
Thank you.
In my capacity as a member of one of your boards, and wish you all the best.
And you're doing a great job as treasurer.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Ուրեմն այդ չափ մեր այսօրվա ծրագրին շնորհակալություն գայտնեմ Fiona Ma նահանգի կանցաբային, որ այստեղ եկավ մեզի հետ զրուցեց. Այդ չափ մեր այսօրվա ծրագրին դեսրին կարճապատ միևնույն գանեն, միևնույն ժամին, մնաք բարով։